have their own. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you.
Not sure. We can share. Is there one more mic or just two? Is there another mic or just one? Okay.
Wait, I can leave now. Before I was forbidden to be seen with something other than our water. Since 2 weeks I could be seen with.
You can do whatever you want now.
I can do whatever I want. That's cool.
Wait till you see Danny.
No, no, no.
This is gonna be one of the best panels, private show for Kyle. I'm just charging my computer.
So I can go whenever. Okay. Wonderful. My name is Dani Nierenberg. I'm so delighted to be here in the Eco Pavilion. I am the president and co-founder with Bernard Pollock of Food Tank. We are a research and advocacy organization really devoted to highlighting stories of hope and success in food and agriculture systems. And I get to be on a panel with two people I really admire and think the work that they're doing is very important. So let me introduce them. First, we have Keith Ogata, the CEO and founder of Producers Trust. The Producers Market app on the Producers Trust platform works with 1,300 plus producer groups across more than 100 countries. The platform reaches over 2.5 million farmers through its produce network and partnerships with associations, cooperatives, and extension services and other providers. And we can talk more about that more. And then I get to see my good friend, Maren Doles. He is an activist, really working towards a regenerative future. He's held a lot of roles, but I'll just talk about the one he's doing now. Maren is the managing partner at Now Partners, a co-convener at the Future Economy Forum. He's also a lecturer at HEC Paris and a former head of open innovation and circular economy at Danone. And he's a mover and shaker, as both these gentlemen are. I'm really so happy to be here because we're going to talk about where we are with scope three. So this is a question for you both. The challenge for the agriculture community right now is that there isn't accurate data reporting at the source, at the key, at the farm level. And the practices and impacts that really impacts what happens, you know, for farmers, which creates many problems for companies, right? And so I want to talk about what those problems are. Why is the lack of data, first of all, just so I can wrap my head around it, really causing problems for corporations and food businesses?
So thank you. I think the first challenge is if we look at the numbers, 87% of the impact is roughly scope three within the food system. So basically, if you make any commitment as a food company, then you only have data today on 13% of your footprint. And if we realize that the food industry is the one industry that cannot just go to net zero, but that has to be the sink that allows all other industries to improve.
Sure.
But to make air traffic be regenerative is going to be very hard. Food has that opportunity. And so now you need to capture those 87%, and it's 87% in the mother of all man-made complex systems.
Sure, sure.
So that is the fundamental issue.
Keith, do you want to build on that, or has Maren done enough?
Maren did a great job. It's a complex topic, and if we're going to achieve net zero, we first need to know what are the impacts today. And it's been 30 plus years of separating the brands from the source, working through complex networks of brokers, traders, distributors, wholesalers. And so now, all of a sudden, with ESG reporting, public disclosures, pressure from not just governments, but consumers, industry groups, to know what's happening at the source in terms of impacts, these corporations are like, what the heck am I supposed to do?
Right, right. And they're really being held accountable by activists, although we haven't seen many of them here in Egypt, unfortunately, because they've been tamped down for political reasons. But I think that consumer angle and what you're trying to do is really important, because consumers are demanding transparency. And if 87% of, according to Marin, of you know, can't be seen, is unknown, then that's a real problem. And so you have all these companies talking about transparency and traceability. So, but if they don't know what that 87% looks like, then are they lying? What are they doing?
I kind of relate this moment as all the antelopes who are waiting to cross the river, and there's a bunch of, you know, crocodiles that's going to eat some of them. And there are companies that might have a few supply chains that are excellent, and they know the transparency, and maybe the impact isn't much, but I feel like they're concerned to communicate to consumers.
Sure.
Because then they're like, whoa, now you're showing me about this one supply chain. What about the other 38,000? What's going on there that sure. may or may not have good data? And if they do have data, it might be negative. And the second area is that for legal reasons, it's increasingly a risk for corporations to talk about sustainability in tangible terms if they don't have data to back it up.
Got it. Marin, can you build on that, like the risks that corporations are facing? And then we'll talk about the risks that farmers have.
Well, I mean, to come back to your question, I think we're collectively lying. Food companies have really good data on their 2-3 biggest crops or ingredients, where they typically have direct supply chains. They're fully integrated. They know exactly where it comes from. Anything else, it's completely opaque.
Sure.
However, we've collectively accepted that there are certain standards and certified metrics that we all use. But I can give you one example of that. The certified metrics for anything that uses fruit is basically the average of fruit. Now, I think we all understand that if I use a strawberry or I use mung bean, it is going to have very different impacts.
Right.
Do I use a stone fruit? Do I use a fruit that is an annual or a perennial? But we've just accepted, but it's certified. That's what we do. Three organizations have certified this database.
Sure.
And so in a sense, there we are collectively lying to one another. What that does is it doesn't send the right signal into the market. So if you're a producer who's doing all the effort to actually have not even less of a harmful impact, but have a positive impact, you're not being rewarded for it because it's simply not visible. And so the company I used to work at, Danone, has 1,700 people working in product development. And we did some research with the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. We found that there are 40 million people in the world that earn their living designing food, developing recipes, developing products. If they cannot see the impact of the decisions that they're making, then you're not going to be able to drive the product to the market that
right.
then in the market is going to allow the consumer to vote with every euro, dollar, whatever currency you use
sure.
for the world that they want. And so that's really, for me, why we need that data. The risk for the companies is huge. If you take a food company spends 40 up to 50% of their revenue roughly in cost of goods. That is the vast majority, over 90%, is mm-hmm. agricultural products that they're buying for most of them. And if you look at some of the reporting, their exposure is a factor 2 to a factor 5. So if you just do the math on that, say we have a 10 billion company, the 10 billion company is buying 5 billion in raw materials, and their exposure, let's say, is a factor 3, it means they have a 15 billion exposure.
Wow.
So the second with all these regulations that externalities start to come in, there's no more business model.
Absolutely. Of course, Keith.
Yeah. I just wanted to, that was a great answer, and I wanted to dive into one piece of it, which Please. Now you're, let's say you're able to segregate from that bean from the strawberry. So let's take the strawberry. Well, if you're using inferred data, public databases, some type of other metrics, we both know that a farmer here in Sebastopol, California, and his farmer next door in Sebastopol, California, if you use a generic database, they'll say that strawberry has the same energetic, impact value, but maybe one is a permaculture farmer who does all these practices and the other is a traditional conventional farmer. And yet it's not looking at the individual practices and outcomes of each farm.
Yeah, absolutely. That's such a great point. So when you're trying to get this data, so companies are looking at it as such a huge risk, but they need it because they need to comply with their ESG standards. They need to, make things more palatable and make consumers want to buy them. So let's talk about what this data collection looks like and why ICA and others want it to be done.
It's a loaded question. I think one of the challenges to data collection is every supply chain is unique, every geography is, every product category, it's all made differently and has different variables. The reason why, from an ICA perspective, from a farmer perspective, they want it done, because with better data, you can make better decisions.
Sure.
You can have better understanding of which markets to go to, marketability, how to tell that story more effectively. But increasingly, to be able to capture data for this purposes of what we're calling scope 3, to have accurate data for reporting purposes, that data can also potentially be used to get carbon credits, to build a baseline and then show how over time carbon is sequestered through these improved practices. And then that becomes an incredible revenue stream for those farmers.
It can become.
It can be, as long as they earn the credits and they're, sold.
Well, there's a level playing field between companies who are collecting the data and the farmers who are giving the data.
Yeah, and right now, these methodologies are benefiting very large farms because of the auditing costs that goes in. So it might be easier to do a scope 3 or build that carbon credit for a 2,000 hectare cattle farm in Australia that's moved to holistic grazing practices versus 1,000 small coffee farmers in the middle of Ecuador who are now doing agroforestry. Sure. Now you got to do audits across many small farms.
Absolutely. But if you look at a company like Unilever, which is sourcing, all over the world, many types of products, how can they be part of the solution? Can they be part of the solution in helping farmers receptive to working with them to provide this data and also benefiting from it?
I think Unilever has to be part of the solution and they have to benefit from the solution, as an example. And the way they're going to get there is through multi-stakeholder collaboration. And that collaboration is going to be with public, governments, nonprofits, extension service agents, groups on the ground who can help to organize and register data. It's going to be with technology companies that are using satellites, IoT, transactional data, blockchain. It's going to be everything and anything to bring this together. And ultimately, which I'd love for you to talk on more, it's going to be on Unilever working with Nestle, working sure. with Danone through these systems of anonymized data so that they can share the intelligence of the data without giving up their proprietary information.
Absolutely. Marin, I'd love you to comment on that.
Yeah. The only way you can keep, again, it's the mother of all man-made complex systems. So the only way you can prevent prohibitive transaction costs is if you have, if you leverage the network effect of the data. Basically, all the big food companies buy through some of the same vendors. Fruit comes from 3 to 4 players. Starches come from 2 to 3 players. And if every one of the food companies is going to go to them and say, I need this standard, I need that standard, I need that standard, and I, by the way, need it from your all 60,000 farmers, that's simply unmanageable. But if you have a player in between that can build that data lake, that also is agnostic, that doesn't have an agenda, that doesn't have a religion, but that actually is simply moving with science. Because if you think about data, who was talking about biodiversity 10 years ago? People weren't even talking about it, and nobody was really looking into measuring it. And now everybody wants to know it. And we might think that we know everything today, but we don't.
Sure.
Something will pop up and pop around the corner tomorrow that we need to know. And so that go-between where you have that data lake needs therefore to be agnostic and simply follow science and start to onboarding the data. Big organizations need to understand that that's not what they should be competing on.
Absolutely. This should be a thing that we can all get around: sustainability, improving livelihoods, protecting biodiversity, protecting waterways. I wonder, you know, for me, it comes down to the farmer. But for the farmer, beyond carbon credits, what else can they benefit from like having all of this data and working with companies on this particular thing?
Yeah, I mean, I'll really briefly mention it and give it back to you. But in the end, it's getting their story out there. I mean, the farmer is often seen as the villain.
Right.
And the farmer's not the villain. The farmer's simply working within a system that we've created, which is an industrial system where we were focusing on yield and a centralized system. If the farmer wants to get their story out there, then that data and those channels are very important for that farmer to get the story out there. Farmers in my own neighborhood where I live in the Netherlands are able to go to a much less intensive farming of, let's say, pork. But because they're starting to get their story out there, because they can sell direct to the market, they can actually make a very healthy business model. And in Absolutely. The end, that is what we need. We need healthy business models for farmers.
Absolutely. Keith, where do cooperatives and farmers associations fall into this?
Yeah, great question. And that ties into building on as well what Marin shared. And it's the storytelling. And if you start at the end of the value chain with the brands, right now, they're looking at scope 3 as a big risk. You know, the CFO is nervous because they could lose billions of dollars in lawsuits, litigation. But on the other side, it's marketing. There's a fast growing segment of consumer populations that really want purpose from a brand.
Young consumers who are not going to put up with anything else.
That's right. They want purpose and they want trust. The only way they're going to get trust right now is when you have validated data that they can see that's transparent. And so that trickles down or up to the farmers who then can benefit by having a premium product that's a premium product that's not a commodity, because now they've created a story and they've created something that is unique and differentiated because each farm is different. And if they are then transitioning into better practices, carbon credits, okay, that may or may not be there, but a great story and people wanting those products,
sure.
That's only growing.
Sure. That leads me to a question for you, Marin, because I believe the story behind the product is so important, but Danone had a problem two years ago now. What I'm trying to get at is reducing the risk for the farmers. I know we want to reduce risk for companies who are doing this because we want them to source better. But when you the risk for the farmers is also great, because if you have consumers who are, you know, as Keith pointed out, you know, want mission driven products that have a story behind them. Danone had farmers who were producing milk in a really sustainable way. They could tell that story, but then they let them go overnight. And so that creates a real risk for farmers.
Yeah, and this is why innovation within the food system really needs to be systemic innovation, and it needs to be place-based innovation. What you're referring to, for example, is that the system as we know it today is a centralized system. So what you get is you get one big factory that produces all the potato chips, yogurts, whatever you want for a given country. That means that you need to get enough of the raw materials in a certain radius around that factory. And if you think about, for instance, a product like milk, you can't ship milk 500 miles. I mean, it's basically 90 somewhat percent water. So the economics at that point don't add up. If you want to go to a regenerative system, then you simply don't have enough land around it and to be able to graze those animals. And so what happens then is that you can no longer support the farmers that are further away, even though they're doing exactly what needs to be done, because you can't get it to your factory. And so that's also why a food system needs to be a much more distributed system, where you go back to regional systems,
right?
And where you reduce that scale. That doesn't mean that you only do local necessarily. You need connections between your system. But when it becomes regional, you can break that cycle. And another cycle that you break at that point is that right now, companies can make these economics work for their core crop. But when you're only monocropping, typically all you can do is you can reduce the harm, and you can probably get to almost no negative impacts or no negative impacts. The second you go to positive impact regenerative, you're going to have to diversify what you do in the farm. That de-risks the farm because you're going to have multiple income streams. Therefore, you're also going to reduce your risks. However, it is much harder to now get long-term offtake contracts, because that's another key area of risk for farmers, is the duration of their offtake. Long-term offtake contracts, if you're growing all of a sudden nine things, because Danone might want your milk, but if you need hazelnut hedgerows, Danone doesn't need hazelnut for the next 10 years. So who's going to buy your hazelnuts? And that entire domino effect works through the current centralized system. You can break that, but you need to break that by really going in regionally and building up the system from beginning to end at that new scale.
Absolutely. Well, this is a question for you both. I was, you know, one of the things that was a silver lining of the pandemic for me was this interest in regionalized and localized food systems. And so I got very excited and talked to everyone I know who was like interested in this. And then it kind of fizzled out, right? And so here we are at another COP, where we're, you know, there are lots of big food companies who are sponsoring it. And we're not talking about that regionalization that needs to happen within a globalized system. We're always going to want coffee and bananas and chocolate and all those wonderful things. But I wonder how we reinsert this, like that vigor for regionalization that we saw during the pandemic. Keith?
Yeah, so a lot of times these regional economies don't have a lot of middlemen intermediaries. So in a way, it detracts some of that corporate outcome. And I think where it gets reinvigorated to build off what Marin was saying is from those secondary harvests. Because in our project in Jamaica, this agroforestry coconut project we're developing, you know, the coconuts, they're going to be, you know, dehusked. And those coconuts are going to go locally to the local, you know, supermarkets, the hospitality, some of the Caribbean islands, and we're going to send a lot to Miami. But then from these productions, we're going to have breadfruit, we're going to have ginger, turmeric, yams, cassava, aki. These are all local crops.
Sure.
So I think we should be looking at these secondary systems, since the yields aren't going to be that high. We need to start building localized marketplaces for the non-commodities.
Love it.
And start looking at how can the public sector institutional purchasing be leveraged to buy out and de-risk these secondary crops. And then I think culturally, we need to return back to some of the heritage of where these cultures were consuming previously. Where maybe in Jamaica, breadfruit, which used to be a staple, now has given way to wheat or corn-based products. Sure. There has to be an education or cultural movement towards embracing these products. And in West Africa, in our Fonio project, again, rice has become the big champion of the food system, sure. But they don't grow rice in Mali. They grow Fonio and millets and sorghum. So sure. I think it's a cultural shift and a market demand shift locally.
Yeah, and that cultural shift, I think, really requires building sort of, a patriotism, if you will, for the foods that are grown in your own country. And because Fonio is looked at and millets and sorghums are looked at as poor people's food, and making them the foods of the future, I think, is really important. So diversification is key. But I also think what we need is a diversification of power. So I want to bring it back to farmers and how they work with these corporations to really, have an equal say, to be part of this conversation, not to be told what to do, but to be beneficiaries from the beginning, but also, real negotiators from the beginning.
I'll start off quickly and pass it. One of our last meetings here is with five different associations from Bolivia, and they all have similar struggles related to either financing or markets. And on the market side, there's quinoa. And of course, Bolivia can only eat so much quinoa. That's an export crop. So they're going to rely on having to get to, 40,000 pound containers, buyers internationally, and getting there. And then there's other groups doing potatoes that go to the local market, yet they both have this challenge.
Sure.
So I think corporations, whether small distributors locally or big conglomerates, I think it's just an authentic engagement and turning this from, I'm a buyer, I buy from you at the lowest cost, to saying we share the same outcome.
Right.
And if our farmers go out of business or are suffering, then we're not going to have raw materials to sell and have our business. And that interrelated dependency Absolutely. Needs to be embraced and celebrated.
It's relationship building. It's very core. Maren.
Yeah, I would say it even beyond relationship building, it's a shift in the paradigm. It's a shift in the way we look at an organization or a community. Because why do we put together social plans when we have to close a factory? But when we have to pull out of a certain region, we just give the farmers notice. And that's it. So what that signals is that if you're employed, we consider you within. If you're a farmer, we consider you outside. And for me, that is very much a paradigm shift.
Absolutely.
Of what we see as inside and outside. Now, there's some good signals as well, which is, what we're already seeing is that when you want to go into these higher value added products, regenerative products, organic products, demand is starting to grow to the point that farmers can basically choose who they work with. And so there you can see the balance shifting.
Sure.
There is a fundamental flaw in big food. Big food has two major things on its balance sheet. One is its production assets. That's, by the way, in my opinion, one of the reasons why that conversation about distributed systems is not happening, because it's a sunk cost and they don't have a clue how to write that off.
Sure.
Second is brand equity. Brand equity can stay there unless you really screw it up. It's going to be just fine. But there's something fundamental missing. And what's missing is the land that you ought to be stewarding. But because it's not on the balance sheet, a food company becomes a growth investment, expected to return to yield growth year on year. But market economics, therefore, will tell you to sweat your assets, which means you're going to sweat your land and therefore destroy the land. Would that land have been on the balance sheet? And I'm not saying that therefore corporates need to buy the land, but in different ownerships model, would that land be on the balance sheet? You would be a cash flow investment.
Absolutely.
And you'd start to take care of that land. And for me, that is a fundamental flaw. So I think there's really a question also, what does the future food company look like?
Right. There's so much opportunity there. There's so much excitement. Like, just sort of thinking about that question makes me excited.
Yeah. I mean, look at Intrinsic Exchange Group calculated, together with the New York Stock Exchange, the value that we create in social ecological service capacity every year. And that's not just farmland, working land, as they refer to it, but let's say that a quarter of it is farmland. That total value is estimated today at $125 trillion with a T, US dollars.
Wow.
So even if we're talking about a quarter of that, that's bigger than the current food industry. So there is, to your point, there's a humongous opportunity out
there. Sure.
And so we will see that shifting. We will see innovation there. And that's what we should foster.
We need it now, Maren. So that's where my final question is about the urgency of all of this. So, you know, this is my second week at COP. We're all sort of like tired. We're frustrated. We're a little bit angry at some of these negotiators. And so I wonder what your call to action is, not just for the negotiators who, you know, we whatever. At this point, that's how I feel. But what can we do to inspire those of us who are planning for momentum around, you know, reversing the climate crisis over the next year before we get to Dubai?
So I believe the private sector, entrepreneurship and business is going to drive this forward. It's 70% of the global economy is through private sector. And as soon as the corporations who have that power to make a difference in their supply chains wake up and realize that there's massive risk and massive opportunity to be more ambitious, connecting with farmers and really supporting them in authentic ways, once that becomes a profitable outcome, it's going to scale so fast and shift so many things. So my message every day is biggest food companies in the world, I hope you're listening out there or one day are, come to the table and let's work together to use your purchasing power to drive bank industry, insurance industry, to put lots of money into helping the source scale and shift.
Right on. Thank you.
Hard to go after that. yes, the negotiations are frustrating. I'm very happy to see that it was actually business that said, we are not striking 1.5. That to me was interesting to see. Negotiations are important because the negotiations and the rules of the system are like the homeostasis of a system. And it's trying to typically push any new innovation down. So regulation policy can do one of two things. It can either further entrench the existing, or you can drive for policy that will help change, hit that positive feedback loop and start to morph the system as a whole. However, the change is never going to come from the heart of the system. The change always comes from the edges, from where you experiment. And the beauty about business is that it's darn pragmatic. And so I don't believe that the change is going to come from those negotiation tables. I believe that the change is going to come from everybody, every entrepreneur who's trying different ways. However, it's at the negotiation tables where we can put in place the policy that will then benefit it, and therefore it will become a new normal, and a regenerative economy can become a new normal. Can it be done in a year? It should. I don't know. However, I take my hope from the Copernican Revolution, where in a fairly short time, we had a fundamental shift in the way we perceive the world. I think that we are somewhere in the next Copernican Revolution.
I hope so. I want to thank you both so much. This has been a riveting conversation. I want to thank the Eco Pavilion for hosting this. And thanks to all of you for listening. Wonderful. Round of applause.
And thank you, Danny, for all your amazing work moderating.